Hello, and welcome to Botfield. This video is the first of several videos talking about different pathfinding algorithms. A pathfinding algorithm is something that finds a path from one spot on a map or graph to another. Today we're going to be looking at the Wavefront algorithm and Dijkstra's algorithm. In order to understand pathfinding, you first have to understand what I mean by graph. A graph is something that is made up of nodes and edges. Edges have two nodes, and nodes can have as many edges as you want. This makes a graph. In a graph, Tango, our little robot, can be on a node, and can have a goal or final destination of another node. Each edge has a cost associated with it that describes how hard it is to get from one node to another. This cost can represent how long it takes Tango to go from one node to another. It could also represent how difficult the terrain is between two nodes. Or it could just be that Tango's evil brother is sitting between two nodes, and Tango really doesn't want to bump into him. For most of the pathfinding algorithms we are going to talk about, the costs can't be negative. Occupancy grids, which we talked about in the last video, are actually just graphs, where all the edges have the same cost. Each grid square is a node, and the edges represent how the robot can move. In this graph, Tango can move only vertically or horizontally, one square at a time. That's why the edges are only in those directions. If we wanted Tango to move diagonally, we would just need to add diagonal edges. But how do we find a path to a goal in this mess? One way is to use the Wavefront algorithm, which is very similar to breadth-first search. In breadth-first search, you have a starting node and a goal. The computer can only check one node at a time. So how does it find the path to the goal? It will start by checking the nodes that are attached to the starting node. If those aren't the goal, it will take the nodes it just looked at and see if the nodes attached to those are the goal. And then it will do that again until it finds the goal. Once it's done this, it's found a path. The Wavefront algorithm is just a way of doing breadth-first search on an occupancy grid. The difference is that when it searches a square, it labels the square with the number of steps it would take the robot to reach that square. Once a square has been labeled, it won't be relabeled. When the algorithm reaches an obstacle, it doesn't label the obstacle because the robot can't move there. Eventually, we'll reach the goal node, and the number on the goal node will tell us how many steps it would take the robot to get there. If we follow the numbers in descending order, we can find several paths that lead back to the robot. But this algorithm doesn't always work. Say we want Tango to move on this line. It takes 3 moves, which means a cost of 3. But what if between two squares there's a speed bump that takes twice as long to go over? This is the same as the edge between two nodes having a cost of 2 when all the rest have a cost of 1. For example, going into the square in this direction has a cost of 1. But going over 3 speed bumps like this has a cost of 6. That means that going around the speed bumps is actually faster than going over the speed bumps. If the costs on the edges aren't all the same, the Wavefront algorithm doesn't work. Wavefront counts steps, not path cost. That means that regardless of how many speed bumps you put in, the Wavefront algorithm will act as if they aren't there. You may want to just take 2 steps when going over a speed bump. I want to make it clear that if you do this, it isn't Wavefront anymore. But if we do this as an example, you end up with situations like this, where you would need to replace numbers, add rules, or change how you do Wavefront in order to find the shortest path. This is where Dijkstra's algorithm comes in. Dijkstra's algorithm is exactly the same as Wavefront when all the costs are the same, but it has some extra rules that allow it to work when the costs aren't the same. We're going to use a graph for Dijkstra's because it's easier to see what's going on. In Dijkstra's algorithm, there is a starting node and a goal node. Instead of labeling each node with a number of steps it takes to get there, we label it with the lengths of the shortest path we have found to the node so far. If we haven't found a path to the node yet, we say the path length is infinity. At the beginning, the starting node is the only one with a number other than infinity, since the path from the starting node to the starting node has length 0. We explore the graph from the smallest node to the largest, starting with the starting node. Let's take a look at the first few steps. We're going to use this gray Tango to show what node the algorithm is currently looking at. First, we're going to explore all the nodes attached to the starting node, exchanging the infinities for the lengths of the paths we just found. Now that we've done this, we have no reason to explore these edges again in the future. We want to find the shortest path. Any path that went along one of these edges again couldn't possibly be the shortest path. Let's gray out the lines and the starting node so we know not to explore them again. Another thing we know about this graph is that there is no shorter path to this node than the one we have already found. Can you see why? Edges can't have negative values, and all the other nodes are larger than 3. That means that any path that goes through those nodes will have a length larger than 3. This node could lead shorter paths to other nodes, though. Let's explore a little more. We found the path to the goal node, but there are still a lot of smaller nodes that could lead to a shorter path. Let's keep going. Once again, any path going back through this node will have some kind of loop, so let's gray it out so we know not to look at it again. The next smallest node has a path length of 5. And here, for the first time, we find a shorter path to an already labeled node. 7 is less than 10, so we replace the 10 with a 7. Next comes the 6. When there is a tie for the smallest node, we just pick one at random. We found another path to the goal, but this one happens to be bigger than the path we already found, so we won't replace it. Now the goal node is the smallest node. Exploring things attached to the goal node wouldn't change the path we found, so we can just stop. We found the shortest path. Dijkstra will always find the shortest path so long as there aren't any negative costs. You might have noticed that there's a node at the bottom that isn't attached to anything. Even if we explored the whole graph, we will still have infinity on that node. This kind of makes sense, since you could move infinite times on the graph and you still wouldn't reach that node. On an occupancy grid, instead of having edges that have some cost, you might have grid squares that are more expensive to cross. For example, these green squares have a cost of 2 to enter instead of a cost of 1. Using Dijkstra's to explore the graph looks very similar to Wavefront, but it can handle graphs where not all the costs are the same. But all these algorithms will explore parts of the map that bring them further from the goal. Not only this, but they have to explore a large part of the map in order to find the shortest path. On big maps, that takes a lot of time. That's why both Wavefront and Dijkstra's algorithms are often used to find the shortest path from one node to every other node, rather than the shortest path between two specific nodes. In future videos, we'll be talking about algorithms that are designed to find paths between two nodes as quickly as possible, so don't forget to subscribe.